Adam, this double pyramid, people have been explaining why it's of practical value, but give us some context why it matters.
What I like about it is the fact that it does place the food choice decisions into an environmental context. You have various ways of arranging the foods, which I think is very useful for the consumer. So the first pyramid is nutritional, and it tries to distinguish between foods which are nutrient-rich from the foods towards the top that really give you the empty calories. But dietary choices carry costs. Each choice carries some kind of a cost to the consumer. And so the costs are on the other pyramid. And here we're looking at the financial cost. Some foods are cheaper than others. It costs more to consume some nutrient-rich foods, but not all of them. Which ones are the ones that are both nutrient-rich and affordable? The double pyramid gives you water cost. The water resources aren't unlimited. We need to preserve the water resources. The double pyramid gives you acreage and ecological resources. And then one component that's missing, which I would like to see there as well, is the component of sociability and society, because eating also causes happiness. And are there some foods that don't promote happiness, in which case they are not good for you or for the people around you or even for the planet? So we need to look at the food choices in terms of nutrition, monetary cost, water cost, ecological cost, and the promotion of happiness. And all of those really are the true measure of sustainability, and I think the double pyramid does that quite well.
That's quite a context. Take us into your latest research, though, shopping for health. You've been saying today, you know, we shop because of who we are. What's your research driving at?
We eat depending on where you live, where we live, and where we shop. So we're actually right now doing a study in Seattle where we attach GPS tracking devices to a cohort of 500 shoppers, and we follow them, or at least the device follow them, all the way from their home to the supermarket, to work, to the restaurant, and each time they buy food, or each time they eat food, or they shop for food, they press a button. So we have actually traces for 500 people collected every 10 seconds for a week. We're in the realm of big data. It's 25 million data points telling us everything about consumer behavior. It's actually very fascinating because this is the first map of where people eat together, where they intersect, what restaurants they go to, which shops they go to. It's very, very fascinating. And this is the first time that this kind of work has been used in the service of health, not for marketing research, but in research for wellness and health. That's very novel, I think.
Certainly is. Adam, thanks very much indeed.